Good morning to you. Beautiful day today. This is the day the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. Yes, we're glad to be here. There's joy in the house. We welcome you in Jesus' name. If you are a guest here today, we especially welcome you. We know that God has something to say to you today and something to say to all of us today through His Word. And if you're watching online, we welcome you as well. You can get connected with us by text message through our text in church. Send the word connect to that number you just saw. We'll see it again at the end. Today, our stewardship series on various aspects of our Christian living continues. I've titled it, It's a Matter of Trust. And today we get to the taboo subject of talking about money. Now, those of you who are guests here today are going to say, yeah, that's right. All the church ever talks about is money. Those of you who are here regularly know that that's not true. I have not had a standalone message dedicated to money and how we manage it in the 8 years and a half that I've been here. So I think it's about time, don't you? Yeah, it's part of our stewardship. And so I'll be sharing with you from Luke's gospel the words of Jesus about how generous God is. That's the foundation of all of our response of stewardship. The giving of our lives, our time, our talent, our spiritual gifts, our money, it's all based in God's generosity. We'll talk about that today. It's not going to hurt a bit, so don't go away. I think you'll be blessed. And our focus note today is that money poses the biggest threat to our spiritual lives. Because the Bible says money can become your God instead of God being God. And it says that the love of money is the root of all evil. Not money, but the love of money is the root of all evil. And as our generous Lord has given to us so much, He wants to show us an abundant favor in all of our lives, including our financial lives, even during an economic recession. So He says, give, and it will be given to you. And that's a matter of trust. Do you trust God or not? If you do, give freely, and He will bless you more than you can imagine. For today is Hebrews 13:5. Where the writer says, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. That's the word of the Lord. Rise for the opening hymn, please. Come, thou fount of every blessing.
Hey, we're going to stand here just for a moment in this open in heaven and say thank you, Father God, for all that you have brought to us and drop upon us like a fountain flowing over us, like a river running through us. Cleanse our hearts, cleanse our minds. And Father, I'd ask for a special blessing on each and every one of our congregants today, that the Holy Spirit would come with fresh wind and fresh fire and sit on the very throne of their hearts, and that their ears would be open to hear the words that Pastor Mark has prepared for us. So thank you, Father, for this opportunity. And we say thank you, all of us, in Jesus' name, amen. Come, thou fount of every blessing. Good morning, Vicki.
Come, thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, by my wandering heart to
invocation. In the name of the generous Father, the sacrificial Savior, and the outflowing Spirit, visit us with your loving presence, O Lord. Amen. Would you read together with me, please, the confession? God, your generous goodness comes to us new every day. All that we have and are belongs to you. We confess our selfishness and grief. Forgive our sin and transform us into the image of Christ. Amen. Father, we thank you. God's generous goodness has come to us in the person and the work of Jesus, who gave his life for us. By his death and rising again, we are offered forgiveness for our sins. Rejoice in the generosity of our Lord. And please be seated as we receive the word from Scripture.
The word of the Lord today begins in Malachi chapter 3, verses 6 through 12. Robbing God. I, the Lord, do not change, so you, O descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. Ever since the time of your forefathers, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, how are we to return? Will a man rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how do we rob you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not cast their fruit, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. The second reading is from Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 15. Freedom from human regulations through life with Christ. So then, just as you have received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human traditions and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ. For in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and authority. In him you were also circumcised in the putting off of the sinful nature, not with a circumcision done by the hands of men, but with circumcision done by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism and raised with him through your faith in the power of God, who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all of our sins, having canceled the written code with its regulations that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Would you please stand for the gospel? Gospel today is from the 12th chapter of Luke, 13 through 21, the parable of the rich fool. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" And then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions." And then he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man produced a rich crop. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." And then he said, "This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of good things laid up for many years. Take life easy, eat, drink, and be merry.'" But God said to him, "You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with anyone who stores up things for himself, but is not rich toward God." Here ends the gospel. Amen.
Well, we have a lot of kids at the Washington County State Fair this morning, and adults, and we have others who are on vacation, traveling various places, and so we're a little slim on kids, but we do have 1, 2, 3 kids that I can see. Come on up, Cameron, Caroline, and Danny. Please come forward. I need your help today. Okay. Please stand right here. I'm going to go behind the altar and get something, so you stay right here for a moment. I'm going to talk about some words that Jesus gave us where he said, "Give and it shall be given to you. Full measure, pressed down, shaken together, more than you can handle, for the measure you give is going to be the measure you get back." That's what I'm talking about today with the adults and how generous God is. And I want to have each of you hold one of these little bowls here, little paper bowls that we got out of the kitchen. Adults can see those. And hold those out and take a look at the bowl. What's in it? A lot of nothing, right? And I want to give you something today, so stay right here. I'll be right back in just a moment and give you something to put in that bowl. Okay, that took a little bit of time, but I'm back. You guys like cheese curls? Those are cheese curls. They're like Cheetos. They're not exactly Cheetos, but they're like it. Got something in my mouth. You like them? Say yes. Make my day. Well, I'm going to give you some of these Cheetos. I'm going to give 4 of them to each of you today. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Some of you are going, yuck, but pretend that you like them for a minute. All right. Now, I just ate one of these, and rather than having you eat any of these, I'd like you to give one of these to some adult out in the congregation. Go, and then come on back. Give them away, all of them. Thanks. I should have picked chocolate or something instead. It would have been a much bigger hit. Cheetos. Yeah, you can eat them. You can eat them in church even. That's good. Well, Caroline's back. Cameron's coming. Danny's going to be coming. Now, let's suppose that you guys really love Cheetos, which apparently is not the case. But let's suppose that for a moment, and I just gave you four of them, and you gave all of them away. Is that fair? Where's yours?
Nowhere.
You don't get any? No. I want to have you stay right there. I got something else back here I want to give you. Look at this.
No.
I got a lot of Cheetos. So hold out your bowl, and I'm going to give you more Cheetos, more Cheetos, more Cheetos, more Cheetos than you can possibly handle. I love the laughter. Please don't step on them. Just stay right where you are. That's the message God wants to give you and all the adults today, that He is generous. And that even though we might have a little, we can share what we have, we can give away what we have, and God is so generous, He's going to pour more into our bowl, more into our laps, until we have such an abundance that we can't even contain it all. It falls on the floor, right?
That's what just happened.
That's exactly what just happened. So these Cheetos represent God's good gifts to us and His love for us in Jesus. He pours it into our hearts abundantly. Now, I'm going to have you pick these up in a moment, but right now I'd like you to pray with me. So everybody join their hands and pray after me. Lord Jesus, You taught us to give and we will receive. Make us generous, just like You. You came as the gift above all gifts. And You gave Your life that we could spend eternity with You. May Your rich generosity move us to be generous to others. In Jesus' name, amen. Now I will take these bowls and put them up on the altar as a little reminder of God's generosity. And I'm going to have you pick these up. Here comes the mop. I have something to put them in, by the way, but it looks like I don't need it because Kurt's got it. He's going to carry them right out. Awesome. All right, kids, that was fun. You can go and have a seat. It was great laughs. I love it when people laugh, especially when children laugh. All right, let's rise now and sing the message hymn for today, God Whose Giving Knows No Ending.
For those that are following along at home in the Lutheran Book of Worship, if you'd turn to page 408, that's where you'll find the words. If you want to follow the notes, they're found on the song itself is found on 423, the tune. God whose giving knows no ending.
God whose giving knows no ending. From Your rich and endless store, nature's wonder, Jesus' wisdom, costly cross, bribe, shattered door, gifted by offering up ourselves in praise. song shall rise forever, gracious donor of our days. Skills and time are ours oppressing toward the goals of Christ your Son. All at peace in health and freedom, races join, the church made one. Now the wreck our daily labor, lest we strive for self alone. Born with talents, make us servants, fit to answer at your throne. Treasure to gain through powers your grace conferred, ours to use for home and kindred, and to spread the gospel word. Open wide our hands in sharing, as we heed Christ's ageless call. Serving you my loving all.
Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have to give back to the kingdom all that really is yours. Father, it's not our money. It isn't that we pursue money. We need to pursue love and pursue the love of the Father. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have. And we thank you for the words that have been given the pastor to give to you today in his message. We pray this all in the precious, the powerful, the priceless, the majestic name of the King, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Do you know him? Amen.
Amen. Thanks for that prayer. You may be seated. Today we're going to talk about grace, gratitude, and generosity, the three G's. You can write those words in your notes that we gave you inside your service folder, and that's going to be the theme of where we're going today. We're doing this series that we call A Matter of Trust here at Christ Lutheran. It is a series on stewardship of all of our life, everything we have, our health, our relationships, our time, our spiritual gifts, our talents, the money that God puts into our laps, the assets he gives us. Everything that we have is a gift from God, and we're going to talk about that today. So this is a stewardship series of messages, and I told you on the first one, most people run for cover when they hear the word stewardship because they think that they're going to get beat over the head about money. And we have come in this series to talk about money today, and I want to assure you, you're not going to get beat over the head about anything. Stewardship is not about guilt. It's not about being told you must do something. It is about the free and generous love of God in Jesus Christ. Here's our definition of stewardship we've been using. Stewardship is the free and joyous activity of the child of God in managing life and all of its resources for God and his purposes. You ought to memorize that. That's what stewardship is, the free and joyous activity. And that applies to the giving of money as well. It is to be a free, not compulsive or compulsed or forced in any way, not conscripted, not out of guilt or shame. It is to be given freely, and you're to have joy, not pain, joy when you give to the Lord God and to somebody else who needs that help that you can give. It's a matter of trust. It all comes down to God trusting us with his possessions, and it comes down to our trusting God to give back to him as he's given to us. And today we're focusing on God's amazing generosity. Oops, I have the wrong script on the bottom there. It's not 1 Peter chapter 4. It is in the Gospel of Luke chapter 6, verse 38, where Jesus says these words. And we're going to focus in on the first ones especially. Verse 38 says, "Give and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Great words to think about when it comes to the stewardship of our money. So today's big idea is we tend to be stingy when it comes to money. We tend to hoard when it comes to money. We use a number of different instruments to stash away the good gifts that God has given us financially. And we tend to be rather reluctant to share that with people whom we may not trust. We tend to be reluctant to give it back to God because we know that hard times are coming. The recession is upon us, and it's going to be something that hurts everyone. But on the other hand, the motivation for giving is Jesus Christ. And Jesus is the premier example of the title of our message today, which is God's Amazing Generosity. And so we can listen to the words of Jesus, we can take them and digest them and take them apart and do what they say when Jesus says, give, and it will be given unto you. That's the promise of God. So today, as we think about financial giving, we think about celebrating God's generosity to us, His amazing generosity. You know, I'm walking on dangerous ground here. It's like walking out on a frozen pond. You might just fall through, you know, and drown or something like that. It's a subject that a lot of people don't want to talk about. It's really the last taboo in our culture. There was a time and a day back in the day when we had a number of taboos. Four of them, for example, would have been, you don't talk about religion, you don't talk about politics, you don't talk about sex, and you don't talk about money. Those are the four things you don't talk about. Well, today, people talk about religion all the time. They talk about politics every day. Sexuality is the whole basis of the marketing and advertising that we see on television and here in various places. So there's one taboo left. That's money. It's not polite to go up to somebody and ask them, how much do you make a year? And how much do you have in your savings or assets that you set aside in your IRA? You don't ask those questions because it's not appropriate, right? Well, the last taboo is going to fall today because we're going to talk about money, and it's not going to hurt. You can sit back and relax and take a deep breath and go, this is going to be good. Everybody say it. This is going to be good. All right. So generosity is what it's all about. Give and it will be given to you, Jesus says. And we're going to parse that particular verb there and tell you about what the word give is really communicating to us. But it's about generosity, and it's about God's great generosity. Behind that noun lies an adjective, which is generous, that God is generous, and we as His people can be generous too. What's a generous person? It's someone who is showing a readiness to give more of something, such as time or money, than is strictly needed or than is expected. Somebody who abounds and overflows with something extra toward us. Sound like our God at all? Yeah, certainly is, right? Generosity is the expression of God's heart to us. We deserve nothing, and we own nothing, and yet God comes and gives us everything. That's generosity, and that is the essence of God's heart. His love for us leads Him to be generous toward us. That's the expression of His heart to us. And we're going to start out by saying, as a reminder, everybody, that everything belongs to God. We don't own anything. We are managers, stewards, housekeepers, governors of what God has given to us. We talked about that a couple messages ago. So I don't own anything, really. None of it's mine. I don't own my wife. She belongs to God. I don't own my kids and my grandkids. They belong to God. I don't own my family, extended family, that we're seeing for a reunion next month. Coming tomorrow is next month, right? I don't own them. I don't own my house. I don't own the land that it sits on. I don't own the possessions I have, the cars, the furniture. None of that's mine. I don't own that stuff. I don't own what's in my bank account, my checking account, or my savings account. I don't own what's in my IRA. That's not mine either. Or in my other assets that I've taken and stashed away for a rainy day. I don't own any of that. Everything belongs to God. The Bible says He is the perfect Father, and the giver of every perfect gift comes from Him, who is the Father of lights, and the giving comes from Him so abundantly. It's amazing. The Bible says that everything belongs to Him in Psalm 50, verse 10 and 12a. It says, every animal of the forest is mine, and the cattle on a thousand hills, they're mine, God says. For the world is mine and all that is in it, He says in Psalm 50, verse 10 and 12a. God owns it all. We are to be stewards of the planet that we live on. We are to be stewards of everyone that we meet in our lives and treat them with the heart of God, which is a heart of love that expresses itself in generosity. Another scripture that's really great about God owning everything, especially when it comes to our financial assets, in the book of Haggai, probably have trouble finding that right off the cuff and just looking for it. Might need to use your directory in your Bible. God says, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. That's the Lord God speaking to you, that He owns everything. Everything that we have that's good in our lives, God owns. It belongs to Him. It's not ours. He owns everything. Everything that we enjoy in life. And God gives us everything. You ever think about what God has given you? The body that you live in, well, you say, well, I'd like to trade it in for a new one that's not broken. Or you say, I'd like to look differently than I do. But He's given you your body. He's given you all you need to support this life in your body. You're still here. You're still kicking, right? You're still vertical. Well, some of you have fallen asleep and are lying on the bench, but that's all right. But He gives us everything. He gives us forgiveness of sins. He gives us life that is abundant right now. He gives us eternal salvation. He gives us all the gifts that we enjoy in our life that are spiritual, that are material, that are relational, that are intellectual. Our mind belongs to Him. So be careful what you let into your mind. Our bodies belong to Him. Be careful what you put in your body. It all belongs to Him. And today we had a scripture from Malachi 3. And it was titled at the top of the section that Shelley read, Robbing God, wasn't it? Is that the title? Yeah. That's pretty harsh. It's pretty harsh what Malachi said. He said, bring the whole tithe, that's 10% of your income and your wealth, into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. And God says, test me in this and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will be not be enough room for it. That's the illustration of the cheese curls, right? More than we can possibly handle. Malachi 3, verse 10. Is it possible to rob God, really? It certainly is. If we follow the advice of a popular song back in the 1980s, it's my life and I'll do what I want, right? That's robbing God. It's not your life. And everything in your life is a gift from God. It's all a gift. So it all comes back to God's grace and our gratitude and then our generosity. The three G's. I'll lay these out again for you in just a moment right here. The three G's of our stewardship. You might want to snap a picture of this or write this down. This really is what we're talking about in this series. First of all, it's the grace or the undeserved love of God. God has given us everything that we enjoy in life. He is not the author of evil. He doesn't give us evil. He's not the author of temptation. If you're tempted, it's not because God's tempting you, the book of James says. It's your own sinful flesh that is rising up and causing you to be tempted by the devil or the world or your flesh, right? He gives us everything that we enjoy now as a gift of His undeserved grace. He says, here it is. It's yours. Now manage it for my purposes. from that gift of grace, we have gratitude in our hearts. If you stop and think about it, and I challenge you to do that today, about the gifts that God has given to you, you're going to have a long list. You start writing them out, you're going to have a long list. You're going to need more than one page. Keep on writing. You're going to need more than two pages. Keep on writing. It's a long, long list. And once you realize God has given those gifts to you, how can you not be thankful to Him for what He's done? That's the power of gratitude. We need to be people who demonstrate gratitude to the Lord by coming to worship and praising Him with our whole heart and thanking Him with our lips and our lives and saying, Lord, I live for You because You have been so gracious to me. And out of that sense of gratitude, that sense of thanksgiving, that sense that I can't believe God has done this good stuff for me, and He's given me all these things in my lives and all these people in my life, He's given it all to me freely and abundantly. Out of that sense of gratitude, there then rises a spirit of generosity, where we say we're going to be generous toward the Lord, we're going to be generous toward people around us, with our time, with the use of our talents, with our money. We're going to be generous to those who are out there in the world who need our support, and we're going to be generous first to God. We'll talk about first fruits giving in another message. So remember those words. It's about grace, gratitude, and generosity. That's how it works. Grace, gratitude, and generosity. That's how we can live for Christ and have joy in our lives and experience abundance, more God gives us and more pours out of our lap or out of our bowl of Cheetos, right? God's abundant grace. About gift of gratitude, grace, gratitude, and generosity. Now, God is the most generous you can get. He owes us nothing, but He gives us everything. He doesn't owe you. You're the creature, not the creator. And yet the creator of heaven and earth has given you the gifts that you enjoy. His generosity comes into sharp focus for us in Jesus Christ. In the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 9, verse 15, it says, "Thanks be to God for His generous gift." That God has given us the most expensive, extravagant, amazing gift that He could give in Jesus Christ. Where would you be without Jesus Christ? You'd be following after the world, seeking to achieve what the world thinks is good, right? You would be living by yourself day by day, trying to connect with people, but somehow missing in some way. You'd be experiencing some loneliness because God was not walking with you directly. God is generous in Christ. Where would we be without Christ? We'd be lost and condemned. We'd be on our way to hell without Christ. Eternal separation from God. Not very rosy picture. But God gave the greatest gift of all, His love, wrapped up in His Son, Jesus. When Jesus was conceived in the womb of Mary, and 9 months later was born of that Virgin Mary, that was God's present to us all wrapped up. The incarnate Son of God, who took on flesh to live a perfect life to where we were imperfect, to walk the way of sorrow and oppression to the cross, and to give His life as a ransom for you and me. The greatest gift we could ever receive. We see that at the cross of Jesus, where He is lifted up from the earth. And He said in the Gospel of John, "I, when I'm lifted up, will draw all people to Myself." That's His goal. He wants to draw everyone to Himself, and He wants to use us to make that happen. He's given us the gifts of the Holy Spirit, Galatians 5. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. The gifts of the Holy Spirit are ours, and the Holy Spirit walks right with us. He lives inside of us as believers in Christ. That is awesome to think about. What great gifts. He gives us the power to gain wealth. In Deuteronomy, we told the people of Israel, when you go into this land that I'm giving to you as a gift, you didn't earn it, remember the Lord your God. Don't forget about him, because it's the Lord your God who gives you the power to gain wealth and to prosper in this new land. Do not forget where that power comes from. It comes from the Lord our God. In other words, God will give you more than you can handle. That's what our text says, right? Go back to that text. What does it say? Jesus says, give it, it'll be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, poured into your lap. That's more than you can handle. For the measure you use will be the measure that's measured to you. All right, I'm rich in object lessons today. I got some other ones to show you today. I think it's no secret to any of you that Linda and I go to the movies frequently. So if you go to the Marcus Theaters and you spend, what, $20 on this bucket? Something like that. You buy this bucket, you can get a large popcorn for a low price. What is it, $5? Yeah, instead of $15 or whatever they normally charge, right? So this pays for itself after a couple visits to the theater, and we're always sure to make sure that we got the bucket when we go to see a movie. And we make sure it's clean. It's in a certain place in the cupboard. We both know where it is. Usually I don't know where things are in the cupboard, but I do know where the bucket is. And if you go to the theater and you stand in the concession line and you say, I want this bucket filled up with popcorn, extra butter, because it's really healthy, right? You will see that the guy will put a little popcorn in it. He'll go over to the butter machine, and then he'll put some butter on it, and then he'll shake it a little bit. So the butter goes around and the popcorn settles in, and they'll add some more popcorn, and he goes and puts some butter on it again and shakes it again. And then he goes again and puts some more popcorn in it, and he shakes it again. And by the time he does this, there's butter on the top, in the middle, and on the bottom, right? And you're looking at your greasy hand wondering, where am I going to wipe this, right? And when he gives it to you, this thing is literally overflowing. Linda goes to the concession stand, and sometimes she will hand this to me, and I start to walk along the way, and I, you know, take a piece, and as I do, I kind of knock the big mountain over, and there's a trail of popcorn down the hallway. Linda always knows what theater I'm in, because she follows after the trail of popcorn. So that's like God. He just overflows toward us in abundance. And he says to us, the measure that you use is the measure that you're going to give back, get back. I have here some of the greatest measuring spoons ever invented. They're magnetic. I gave them to my wife as a gift. What better gift can you give to show love to your wife than measuring spoons? She actually asked for them. Yeah, so I was giving something she wanted. So these are various sizes. You get an eighth of a teaspoon right here on this side of this particular measuring spoon, right? And it goes all the way up to a tablespoon in this last one right here. Now, when it comes to Christian giving, how many of us use an eighth of a tablespoon to give back to God? We don't even think about percentage giving. We just take out a $10 bill or whatever we normally give and throw it in the plate, and that's it, right? And we give back that little bit to God. Or maybe we do a little better than that, and we give a tablespoon to the Lord God, and that's what we give. Well, God says to us, be careful about that, because the measure you use is going to be measured back to you. Now, I may not have the wealth and the abundance to fill this popcorn bucket up to overflowing, but if I give generously to the Lord, he's going to give generously to me. And he will give you more than you can handle when it comes to how he responds to that giving. So that's a promise from God we can rely on. It's something we can build our lives on. All right, let's go. Let's go. Oh, my fault. Let's go. So it's impossible to exaggerate how good God is, how amazing his generosity is. Just think about what God's given to you. I love this quote from Ignatius of Loyola. He said, God will not be outdone in generosity. You're shoveling it out to toward the Lord and other people, God's got a bigger shovel. He's shoveling it back in. You cannot outdo God when it comes to generosity. So give and it'll be given to you. The word here in the Greek I want to parse out for you, it's didote. And didote means to give, offer, put, or place. Very simple little word. You're giving something, you're putting it out there, you're offering something. That's why I call it the offering. The important part of this verb is that it is present, active, imperative. That means, present, active, imperative means that you do it today, you do it now, and you keep on doing it. You don't stop. And the second person plural means you, not just you, Linda, but you, y'all. You all keep on doing it. And it's an imperative. That means you don't have a choice. It's a command. Give and it'll be given unto you. It's a command of Jesus. It has power to it. And it continues not just today, but throughout our lives. Am I making you uncomfortable yet? I hope not. This is not painful stuff, right? So we thank God for everything. That's our response. And we follow the words of Proverbs 11, where Solomon wrote, "One person gives freely, yet gains more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed." That's an awesome statement, right? And did you know that generosity is contagious? If I see someone being generous, it inspires me to be generous. It's like Newton's cradle. I've got three Newton's cradles at my house. I like Newton's cradle. I'm amused for hours just playing with those balls that go back and forth. I didn't bring it today because I had an overload of visuals. So I saved that for another day. But generosity is contagious. One person, like the ball on the left, hits others or impacts others, and they become generous as well. There's a reaction to it that is positive. Paul talks about that to Timothy in his first letter, chapter 6. He said, if you're a generous person, if you do what God's told you to do, in this way, you will lay up treasure for yourself as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that you may take hold of it and take hold of the life that is truly life. Do you want to experience the abundant life? Think about God's generosity and give back to Him. It is gratitude, the second of the G's, that leads to generosity. Here's what Leanne Martin said. God, our gratitude to God compels us to express love for Him by sharing what He's given to us. The love of Christ compels us, Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians. I want to close with a true story that happened to me this week. I was in the post office, one of my favorite places to go. And it's, yeah, we're good time for a little story. I got out of my car, and there was a guy who'd pulled in right next to me. He got out of his car. I was wearing some Greg Norman shorts that I picked up at Ross for 12 bucks. They're usually not that cheap, but I got them at Ross, right? And these are gray shorts, and they got these little black sharks on them. And this is Shark Week, isn't it? Oh, yeah. So this is Discovery Channel Shark Week. So they're very timely shorts. So I'm walking in these shorts with my pale white legs, so white that the sun bounces off of them and blinds you, right? And the guy comes behind me and he says, "Those are really cool shorts. I like them." And I said, "Yeah, they're Greg Norman shorts, the shark." And he walked on and did his business. I went to my post office box, pulled out the mail. There was a lot of it. I started opening it up, slicing it open and throwing away what I didn't need and keeping what I did need. And in the meanwhile, this guy had opened the door behind me for somebody else. He had, I discovered through listening to what happened, deferred his place in line for somebody else. And he came back toward the door, and he was helping a woman who had some packages to make sure that she could get them up to the counter. He had done all these acts of generosity. And as he's walking out the door, somebody said to him, "Why did you do all this?" He said, "I just like to be kind to other people." And he smiled with great joy because he scored at the post office with all these opportunities to be generous. And I looked at him and I said, "Amen, brother." I'm thinking this guy was a Christian just because of his attitude and his great generosity. That's the kind of thing that we can do day by day. As we live our lives for Christ, as we bless others, and as we are generous to the God who has shown amazing generosity to us. And so we give generously with the promise that we will receive, not dollar for dollar necessarily, but we will receive an abundance of joy like this man did, and we'll experience a blessing of walking with God and seeing people's days and weeks and maybe lives transformed by being the generous people calls us to be. There's more to come on this subject. I know a lot of you are asking about the tithe and what does that mean for New Testament Christians. We're going to talk about some of that stuff down the road, but that's it for today. Be generous in all that you do. In Jesus' name, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And now you can rise for prayer as we come to the Lord and offer our hearts and minds to Him. Let us pray to the Lord. Father God, you are the author of every good and perfect gift which comes down from you as the amazing Father of lights in whom there is no variation or shadow of change. We look around ourselves, we look at ourselves, we look at what you have knit together in our mother's womb as you created us. And though age may take its toll on us and neglect may hurt us, we know that we ourselves are fearfully and wonderfully made. We see your extreme generosity in the cross of Jesus Christ, that he was given to be our substitute, that by his death on the cross, he took our place, he owned our crime, and he did the time when we should have been doing the time and paid the penalty. And he purchased for us forgiveness of all of our sins. And he bought for us an eternal life that will never diminish or fade away, that is kept in heaven for us by God's grace, St. Peter writes in his first letter. And you give us the gift of your Holy Spirit who fills us. And you give us the gifts of life, our house and home, our spouse, our friends, our family, our neighbors. You give us possessions to enjoy. You give us money to manage. You give all this to us as a trust that is sacred from you to us. And you call us to walk in the way Jesus walked and to be generous. Lead us to be generous people, O Lord God. Help us to reflect your glory and seek your glory. May we use the income we have, the talent and ability we have, the time we have to serve the kingdom goal of lifting up glory to you and leading people to the Lord Jesus Christ. God, give us a new heart, a heart filled with gratitude for your grace and a life that is demonstrated in generosity. Lord, we thank you for all your goodness to us as a church. We thank you that Vicki Barr has gone through a number of successful surgeries, and she's going back to the Mayo Clinic to get the nod that she's okay. And God, what a miracle she is. And we heard only part of her testimony. Lord, we thank you today for the kids and the adults who are at the Washington County Fair. We thank you for others who are vacationing away from this place. And God, give them rest, give them joy. Lord, we want to give you thanks for all of your gifts, including the gift of new life you've given to Jay and Gail in their grandson, Chance, and to Mark and Jess in their daughter, Eloise. And God, give them a grateful heart for those gifts of life. Lord, we pray for those who need you desperately today. For any person in this church today who is in need of you, I say, God, come to them, and I bless them in the name of Jesus. I put the name of Jesus on them today, a name that will bless them with their need today. And Lord God, I also want to pray for those who are ill. I pray for Cody Kamenzen as he deals with his cancer. May he find the best effective treatment for his disease. May he be cured, and may he give you thanks and gratitude to you for what you have done in his life. Lord, we want to pray for Danny Patterson today. who's in an in-treatment program. We want to pray for Chrissy, who's got cancer. Pray for Lester in his time of need. We give thanks for Andra and Harlow getting over COVID-19. And we bless you for other people that you have healed. Lord God, we want to have you step alongside by the power of your Spirit those who have lost loved ones. This week we heard of the death of Frank Krejci, and he was a man who was generous in giving us, or giving Ed Schad and Angel Share, this land where we ourselves were able to purchase the first floor of this building. So we give thanks that he was generous and that we experienced a blessing from that, and may we as a church be generous. And Lord God, we want to pray for others who are ill or recovering. We want to pray for those who are victims of shootings and are living, and those who mourn those who were killed. Bring peace in our land, Lord God, and let it start with each one of us. Lord, we pray for our church today. We pray that we would be a church that is continually outward focused, that we know that we exist not for ourselves, but for those who are not here. And may we, together with Angel Share, partner to do great things for you and your kingdom here in this place, in our time, at this particular moment, for such a time as this. And Lord, we want to add our names of people that we are thinking about today, and please give those names to the Lord now. Lord, you are ready to hear our prayers and to generously respond to them in your time, in your way, as you know best. So we put our prayers before you in faith, trusting in your promise that you will do for us according to the measure of Christ's love demonstrated to us, and you will bless us abundantly in all of our needs. May we surrender to you, and may we trust you with our lives. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior, who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. We're going to offer up our gifts and tithes and offerings to the Lord now. I would challenge you to think about giving generously. And if you thought you were going to give this amount, add something to it and give this amount instead, as God has generously blessed you. And as we do this, we're going to sing the song that is before us, that we are an offering.
The Apostle Paul wrote in the book of Romans, I beseech you, I beg you, therefore, brethren, y'all, people, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. We are an offering.
We have
can be that offering and you receive that offering. We press down that offering. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen.
Let's all pray together now the offering prayer on the screen. Lord, may our church be a witness to you, immersed in Scripture, constant in prayer, joyful in worship, generous in giving. Make us a loving, supportive community, reaching out to those in need. Accept these gifts we offer in Jesus' name. Amen.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Amen. Now thank we all our God. The Lord be with you. Have a blessed week. Amen. Yes.